We continue to be interested in this Newton isotropy, and actually we collaborate with RCP, the robotization project, on processing of the white-rhythmus data. And one of the issues that sort of keeps coming up is symmetry. And the natural question why we would go back to HTI, which is horizontal transverse isotropy, because our group has done a lot of work on the more general orthorhombic model, and the imaging community seems to be moving on from TI to orthorhombic and tilted orthorhombic models. I actually noticed this shift probably 4 or 5 years ago, and suddenly I began getting a lot of questions about my paper on orthorhombic notation that came out back in 97. And this trend obviously will continue, but for many people working in fracture detection and laser approximation in general, HTI remains kind of their favorite model. So there seems to be a sort of strange disconnect between the imaging community and the characterization community. So this, and sometimes you read case studies and you find HTI being identified with fracture-induced anisotropy. That's pretty common. So the question is, since this HTI model is out there, what role, if any, should it play in our processing portfolio? And that's basically the question for this talk. And I'll try to go through the list of questions on this slide. And some answers are pretty obvious, and I'll have to spend more time on some other questions. But the first one is, how realistic is HTI for describing effective anisotropy, say, of fractured reservoirs, or maybe just the fracture-induced component of an isotope? And the second question, can we really distinguish between HTI and the more general orthorhombic model, maybe triclinic model? And ideally, we would like to estimate the symmetry from the data, and sometimes we can do it with multi-component local AVSP surveys, and Vladimir manages to do it with microseismic, but for reflection data, usually we need a symmetry assumption. And if we do assume HTI, questions are, well, does it really help us in processing? And what kind of distortions can we expect? So I'll have to start with some model definitions. I'll go through them quickly because this should be familiar to most of you. So this is Shingo's rendering of Andreas Rüger's ageless plot, I would say. It's probably 20 years old. So essentially, HTI describes just a single system of penny-shaped cracks. They should have the form, the shape of ablate spheroids, embedded in a pure isotropic matrix. So any deviations from this very simple model will generally lower the symmetry. So shales will never be HTI unless they're dipping at 90 degrees, which probably doesn't happen very often. For, say, sands or carbonates, which are in many cases intrinsically isotropic, we can hope that HTI can describe a single system of cracks in that matrix, but it's also not a given because, for example, these cracks have to be perfectly aligned. So if they have a certain distribution in azimuth, that will also make the medium orthorhombic. So also, we often have multiple crack systems. That's a nice plot from an fMRI log. From Weber and Field, data came from RCP. So here we might have three open fracture systems, and that will make the medium at least orthorhombic. So that's another famous plot generated by Andreas. Now, this orthorhombic model. And here we have, again, we have a single system of cracks, but now it's embedded in a VTI matrix. So here's your fractured shale. Essentially, the medium has the symmetry of a brick. We see mutually orthogonal symmetry planes, but there's no longer a symmetry axis. And these are some other reasons for orthorhombic symmetry. We might have two orthogonal or two identical fracture sets. Triaxial stresses will make the medium orthorhombic. And what I want to emphasize here is that even when the medium should have a lower symmetry in triclinic, in many cases, the stiffness tensor will still be close to the one for orthorhombic media. So, for example, Vladimir Vejchka and Mark Kachanov showed that if we put multiple systems of vertical cracks in a pure isotropic KVTI matrix, the medium in theory, it's triclinic, will stay close to outer orbit with a horizontal symmetry plane. So this notation that we use for outer orbit media is what we can call Thomson-style notation. Vp0 and V0 are the reference vertical velocities for B waves and one of the split S waves. We have two sets of Thomson-style coefficients in the vertical symmetry planes, epsilon, deltas, and gammas. And there is one more delta coefficient in the horizontal plane. And I want to emphasize that this notation has nothing to do with the notion of weak anisotropy, the discussion after Tariq's presentation. So that, basically, this anisotropy coefficient kind of combines stiffnesses in such a way that help us describe our signatures. They capture the stiffness combination that we should care about, whether anisotropy is weak or strong. And HTI is just a simple special case of outer orbit media when one of the vertical symmetry planes is a plane of isotropy, called the isotropy plane. So this is the plane orthogonal to the symmetry axis where velocities are independent of angle. And as a result, the anisotropic coefficients in that plane, they have the superscript 1, which stands denotes the axis orthogonal to that plane. So these coefficients go to 0. The anisotropic coefficients in the orthogonal plane sometimes are denoted with this superscript V, which stands for the VTI model equivalent to that plane. And the delta coefficient in the horizontal plane is not 0, but it's not independent. So we're down from 9 independent coefficients to 5. And actually, I have nothing to do against HTI. It's sort of our dream model for parameter estimation, because if we measure reflection travel times in the isotropy plane, then we can estimate the two vertical velocities. And then from measurements from reflection move-outs in the symmetry axis plane, we can get the anisotropy coefficients. So this is the only anisotropic model for which we can actually build depth model from reflection data. Now there are some special cases for orthorhombic media that I mentioned, I'll mention later, that it also can be possible. But even for VTI, in general, we need additional information to reconstruct the depth scale of the model. And here it's easy to do if we have wide azimuth acquisition. So what I'll do here, I'll go through several techniques that we use in processing of wide azimuth data. There will be no waveform inversion. These are kind of more pedestrian methods, but ones that we use in practice. And I'll try to emphasize the influence of this symmetry assumption on the processing results. And here we're not just interested in, well, processing per se, like flattening our reflection move out. What we would like to do here is sort of to look at the anisotropy and use the anisotropy coefficients as physical attributes. And mostly I'll be talking about P waves, but at the end I'll also briefly discuss move-out inversion of multi-component data. Oops. So these are the subsets of the model coefficients responsible for different signatures in orthorhombic media first. So P wave kinematics depends on Vp0, epsilons, and deltas. So this is a reduction from 9 independent coefficients to 6, which is a big improvement, and that's one of the main advantages of this Thomson-style notation. So in time processing, we're down to 5 coefficients, obviously the known orientation of the symmetry planes. V and MO, 1 and 2, are the normal move-out velocities in the symmetry planes, vertical symmetry planes. We assume that one of the symmetry planes is horizontal. And then we'll have three eta coefficients. Two of them, eta 1 and eta 2, are defined in the vertical symmetry planes, essentially using VTI equations. That's Tariq's favorite eta, exactly the same thing. And then we have another eta coefficient in the horizontal plane. So there is a total of 5 time processing coefficients. And Shaver splitting is determined by its parameter gamma s, which is close to the fractional difference between the vertical velocities of split S waves, and gamma S is basically the difference between gamma 1 and gamma 2. So for each TI median, we assume that the symmetry X points in the X1 direction. We are down to just VP0, epsilon 2, and delta 2 in the description of PV kinematics. In time processing, gets pretty nice because there's only one of the A2 coefficients goes to zero, that the A2 coefficient in the isotropy plane. And the two remaining A2 coefficients are actually close to each other. So we're down to VP0, one of the anemoid losses, and one A2 coefficient. And then the Shaver splitting coefficient will be equal to gamma 2. So this is the introduction, and now let's take a look at the reflection move-out first. So let's say that we have a layer cake model. I'll assume a relatively simple structure throughout the talk that's typical for fractured reservoirs and unconventional place, so there'll be no subsalt imaging here. So let's say that the medium is layer cake, but each layer can be orthorhombic, HTI, which can be BTI as well. And the orientation of the vertical symmetry planes can change with depth. So in this case, P-wave move-out will be determined by the interval NMO velocities, VNMO 1 and 2, essentially by the interval NMO ellipses, A2 coefficients, and the orientation of the vertical symmetry planes. And despite the general complexity of this model, because again, each layer can be orthorhombic, we can describe reflection move-out here by generalized form of the equation that Tariq and I introduced for VTI media. So the form of the equation is exactly the same. The only thing that we need to do here is make NMO velocity minimum and the coefficient eta functions of azimuth. So the first line here describes hyperbolic move-out. VNMO of alpha is essentially the exact NMO ellipse. And then the last term will control non-hyperbolic move-out, and it depends on the eta, symmetry-dependent eta coefficient. So if vertical symmetry planes really change the orientation and depth, then the effective NMO ellipse will be rotated with respect to the principal directions of the eta coefficient, so we'll have to deal with two azimuthal angles, phi and phi 1. And as a result, we'll have these two different azimuthal angles and the expressions for the NMO ellipse and the coefficient eta. So the equation for the NMO ellipse is exact. It's actually, well, NMO velocity is always elliptical for any symmetry and any kind of heterogeneity. The equation for eta is an approximation, but it's a very accurate approximation that works even for strongly anisotropic orthorhombic models. And here I'm operating in the time domain with reflection move-out, but if you migrate your data and if you try to flatten your long spread image gathers, then you will need the same, say, eta coefficients. And that's what often happens in practice when people move on from tilted TI to orthorhombic media, they realize that they need all say eta coefficients to get rid of residual move-out. So, for me, the question here is, will the HTI assumption help in any way? And the answer is, well, actually, no, because even if each layer is HTI, then the effective move-out will still be described by the same equation, and we'll still need all the eta coefficients. If we say that the medium is homogeneous HTI, well, NMO velocity will still be elliptical. One of the semi-axes of the ellipse in this case is equal to the two vertical velocity, but we don't really know about it unless we have depth information, so we'll just get the same NMO ellipse. The equation for eta becomes really simple because again, one of the eta coefficients goes away and the other two are equal to each other. Essentially, this eta equation tells us that non-hyperbolic move-out rapidly goes away when we deviate from the symmetry axis plane. So for a single HTI layer, obviously it's the correct equation, but in practice, this eighth expression won't help us much because normally we have non-hyperbolic move-out in all azimuthal directions. So it's not that practical way to describe long spread move-out. So how do we estimate this move-out coefficients? Typically, we carry out multi-dimensional samples analysis. We can correct for the EVO signature. Essentially, we can correct for polarity reversals. This is the work that Vanos Concelos and GIN are doing here in CWP. So this is kind of a typical Sundance panel in one of the vertical symmetry planes. There is always some degree of trade-off between NMOV losses and A2 coefficients, but at this point we are just interested in approximating effective move-out. And actually we no longer lasted the A2 coefficients for elastic reflection travel time, so this trade-off becomes less of an issue for us. And I'll quickly give you a field data example. That's a case study that we did with Juan. He was here at CWP, comes from Weyburn Field in Canada. The structural setting was relatively simple. Unfortunately, the offset-to-depth ratio for the reservoir itself was relatively small, so we had to operate with move-out from some relatively shallow interfaces. And fractures sort of permeated the whole section, so there was evidence for multiple fracture sets above the reservoir as well. And this is a typical wide azimuth CMP gathers, what we call super bins, after the conventional hyperbolic move-out correction. So here we can see this typical sticks of hockey sticks of residual move-out. And there's a lot of jitter because all azimuths here are mixed together. But definitely there is a strong signature, at least for relatively shallow interfaces. And these are the results of eta estimation. Again, these are effective eta values, so are not less strict. And on the left is the arrow is the orientation of the major axis of the NMOV ellipse, so the direction of the maximum NMOV velocity. So the orientation of the NMOV ellipse, which is indicative of the orientation of the vertical symmetry planes, seems to be pretty consistent throughout the medium, but still we need all the general, all the eta coefficients to approximate reflection move-out. Well, does any of these eta sets look like it can be described by HTI? Well, no, because if the medium is HTI, either eta 1 or eta 2 has to go to 0, and the remaining two eta coefficients have to be close. So clearly, the homogeneous HTI model won't describe reflection move-out here. So the next step for us would be to layer strip move-out or move-out coefficients and find the interval move-out and layer of interest, because again, we're not interested just in flattening travel time surfaces. We would like to tell something about the model from our measurements. And what we use now is called velocity-independent layer stripping. Essentially, we take travel time surfaces from the top and bottom of the layer of interest, and then we can find the interval travel time surface without knowledge of the velocity model if the medium above the target is laterally homogeneous. If it's heterogeneous, then things become more complicated. And this is a more stable way to find interval move-out coefficients compared to the generalized Dix equations, because eta coefficients, effective etas, can be strongly distorted. So what happens then is we can find the interval move-out, and then we can feed the same non-hyperbolic move-out equation to the interval travel times. And that can give us the interval eta values. And in this case, there seems to be a big difference between orthorhombic and HTI media. Of course, orthorhombic equation on top is much more complicated. Actually, it doesn't describe an ellipse. HTI equation, if a certain layer is HTI, then we're back to the equation on one of the previous slides that depends on just a single eta coefficient. And on the next slide, there is an example of azimuthal-dependent eta for orthorhombic media when all the eta coefficients are non-zero. So it is pretty complicated. It has some nodal lines, there are changes in sign. So it's pretty clear that this HTI equation in general will not describe this interval move-out. But there are several issues here. It seems to be that we might be able to distinguish between HTI and orthorhombic media if we use this approach. But one issue is, well, kind of trivial, it's noise. It's a very noisy signature dealing with reflection move-out at very long offsets. So we really need very clean long spread data with offset-to-depth ratios at least close to 2. And the second issue is related to the physical reasons for move-out. So if we're in a gas field, if fractures are dry, they actually produce a medium that's close to elliptical. So the fracture-induced eta coefficients are all close to 0. And as a result, there is no fracture-induced non-hyperbolic move-out. So we cannot really use this signature. for fluid-filled cracks, actually the medium is analytical, it is not zero, but the magnitude of an isotropy is much smaller. But in principle, for fluid-filled cracks, we might be able to use non-hyperbolic move-out to say, to tell whether the medium is orthorhombic or HDI. And also we can, in principle, can distinguish between single and multiple fracture sets, because if we have a single set of fluid-filled fractures, then the azimuthal variation of eta will be described by the HDI equation. For multiple cracks, we'll have to use the more general orthorhombic equation. And here's a quick example. It comes from Ruison Field in Colorado. And again, the offset to depth ratio for the bottom of the reservoir, unfortunately, was too small. So we'll be looking at the shale layer right above the reservoir. It's called UMV shale. And these are the interval eta coefficients that we estimate in UMV shale using non-hyperbolic move-out inversion. So the top row here is the result of this velocity-independent layer stripping wheels. On the bottom is the result of Dix differentiation. Again, the difference is when we apply Dix, we layer strip the NMO velocities and eta coefficients. When we use wheels, then we layer strip reflection travel times. So here the data are pretty noisy, and essentially generalized Dix sort of goes wild. We do not really expect eta values that exceed unity, like 1.2. The results of fields are much more reasonable, and the set of etas again doesn't fit the HTI model. Neither eta 1 or eta 2 go to 0, and we don't really expect HTI to work for shales. The medium is sort of close to VTI, because for VTI, eta 1 and eta 2 should be equal to each other. But the eta coefficient in the horizontal plane is also non-zero, so there's some degree of azimuthal anisotropy. And actually this, eta 3 here is negative, and this means that we're unlikely to have a single fracture set, because in this case the eta in the horizontal plane has to be positive. So that's an indication of multiple fractures. Now let me move on to amplitudes. Here I'll be pretty brief. Now, when the medium is azimuthally anisotropic, the reflection coefficient becomes a function of offset and azimuth, and we use so-called azimuthal AVO analysis to get a sort of high-resolution estimate of fracture density. So the assumption here is that we can get rid of all propagation effects and convert our reflection amplitude at the surface into the reflection coefficient at the target horizon. And then typically we use what's called the AVO gradient, so the initial slope reflection coefficient, to tell something about fractures. And so suppose we have a boundary between isotropic and orthorhombic media, and then the azimuthal variation of the AVO gradient is elliptical, it's close to elliptical. The assumption here, it's not an exact result, the assumption here is that the AVO gradient doesn't change sign with azimuth. And as follows from Andreas' equations, the difference between the AVO gradients in the symmetry planes depends on the shale wave splitting coefficient and deltas in the vertical symmetry planes. VP0 bar and V0 bar here are the average velocities above and below, P and S wave velocities above and below the reflector. So our goal here in general is to estimate the crack density, which requires some relationship between gamma and delta, and these relationships exist for dry cracks and fluid-filled cracks, they'll be different. So what we'd like to do is to map crack density using reflection coefficients. So how things will change if the medium is HDI? Well, not much. The variation of the AVO gradient will still be elliptical, close to elliptical. And we'll just lose one of the delta coefficients, delta 1, which will go to 0. But we'll still have a linear combination of gamma S and remaining delta coefficient in this equation. So what will change is our interpretation of the results, because if the medium is HTI, then gamma S will give us the crack density. We might have only a single fracture set, and that's what we're after. So we just say that, well, gamma S is our crack density, and we can try to map this crack density as a function of spatial location. But if the medium is orthorhombic, and we have more than one fracture set, then gamma S in general will depend on the, will be close to the difference between the densities of what we call the principal fracture, principal orthogonal fracture sets that describe this orthorhombic model. So if we make the HTI assumption, but the medium in reality is orthorhombic, we'll underestimate the density of the dominant fracture set. So in terms of processing, there'll be no error, but this HTI assumption really can help us in interpretation. If we can establish that the medium is HTI, that will help us avoid errors in the interpretation of our results. Another issue here is geometrical spreading. I mentioned that we need to get the reflection coefficient from amplitudes that we measure at the surface. And if the medium above the reflector is mutually anisotropic, then geometrical spreading will vary with azimuth. And this is the geometrical spreading factor in an orthorhombic layer, and computed as a function of offset and azimuth. And especially at longer offsets, you see there is a significant azimuthal variation of geometrical spreading, and it can be related to azimuthal variations in travel time. So if the medium is laterally homogeneous, then geometrical spreading is a function of the travel time derivatives with respect to offset and azimuth. And we already know that at longer offsets, reflection move-out will look different from for HTI and orthorhombic media. And as a result, the geometrical spreading will be also different. And that can, well, if the medium is orthorhombic and if we use the HTI equation, that can distort our reflection amplitudes, reflection coefficient at intermediate and longer offsets. So let me move on to kind of a more exotic signature, which is the P-wave attenuation coefficient. Attenuation obviously is kind of notoriously difficult to measure, but potentially it can provide us with pretty valuable physical attributes, especially for fluid-filled cracks. And here we assume that well, the medium is orthorhombic for both velocity and attenuation, and not only that, the symmetry planes have the same orientation for the velocity and attenuation functions, which is not necessarily the case, but physically it's a reasonable assumption. And then what happens is the attenuation coefficient is described by exactly the same equation as the linearized phase velocity function. So, and even more than that, it has the same form as famous Thomson's velocity approximation for VTI media. So AP0 here is the vertical attenuation coefficient, and delta Q and epsilon Q are attenuation isotropy parameters, which in this case vary with azimuth. So this is an equation for orthorhombic media. So what will change if the medium is HTI? Well, there's no surprise that delta Q, the azimuthal variation of delta Q, is actually close to elliptical again for both HTI and orthorhombic media. But one of the delta Q coefficients, if the medium is HTI, will go to zero. So attenuation analysis is a little bit different from velocity analysis in the sense that we start by estimating the vertical attenuation coefficient. It may be difficult for us to estimate the vertical velocity, but here we estimate AP0 from the spectral ratio method. If we cannot do that, then kind of all bets are off and probably won't be able to estimate delta Qs or epsilon Qs. So once we have estimated AP0, we can go up to delta Q by looking at what we call attenuation gradient. And then we can tell whether the medium is orthorhombic or HTI. At least if one of the delta Q coefficients is zero, chances are the medium is close to HTI. Also, this coefficient epsilon Q, which is responsible for attenuation at larger incidence angles, have a different form in HTI and orthorhombic media, but probably it's a stretch to expect us to be able to extract epsilon Q with high accuracy. Let me give you a data example. It comes from Coronation Field, also in Canada. And here we tried to build an orthorhombic reservoir model for both velocity and attenuation. So the first step was this CD non-hyperbolic move-out inversion that we already discussed. And then we used this velocity-independent layer stripping to find both interval travel time and interval attenuation. Obviously, travel time estimates are much more reliable. And then from interval travel times, we found the interval involved coefficients, and actually we converted them into Thomson-style parameters using vertical velocities of the wells. And from the interval attenuation coefficients, we estimated AP0, which is vertical attenuation coefficient, and delta Q. So these are the NMO ellipses interval, NMO ellipses in the reservoir, kind of strangely shaped acquisition area. I don't exactly know why they did it this way, but that's the data that we received. So the ticks here show the orientation of the major axis of the NMO ellipse, and the color scale shows the eccentricity of the ellipse, or the elongation. So there are obviously some edge effects, but in general, the magnitude of azimuthal anisotropy here is pretty high. But probably the more interesting map is the one for the vertical attenuation coefficient. There are pretty pronounced anomalies in the lower part of the survey. So there are areas of increased attenuation. And they seem to be well correlated with areas of high gas production. So the circles with multiple ticks, like with 8 ticks, indicate good producers, whilst where there's high gas production. And then I think the ones with 4 ticks are poor wells. So there's good correlation between areas of high attenuation and gas production, which is probably related to porosity. We also tried to estimate the attenuation gradients. And this is one of the delta Q coefficients in the vertical symmetry planes. Data are pretty noisy. And there's no clear spatial pattern here. And the plot for the second delta Q coefficient looks also similar. But also there's no indication that the medium is close to HTI, which would mean that one of these delta Q coefficients should go to zero. Now let me move on to multi-component data. So now let's go back to the model that I discussed before, where we have a stack of horizontal layers with orthorhombic or HTI symmetry. But now let's assume that we can record both P and S waves. In most cases, we'll have to deal with mole conversions instead of P or S reflections. But we can transform PS travel times into the travel times of pure SS reflections using, for example, the PP plus PS method. And then we can find the effective NMO ellipses. And I'll give you a field data example a few minutes later. Of NMO ellipses of all three waves, P wave, fast S wave, and slow S wave. And then now we can use generalized Dick's equation to convert this effective ellipses into interval ellipses. But if the medium is orthorhombic, general orthorhombic medium, then we still cannot constrain the Thomson-style coefficients just using NMO velocity measurements, even if we have all three modes. There is an exception that I'll mention later on, but in general, we need some additional information. It's actually the case even for VTI media. But if the medium is HTI, and here's, we are back to the HTI model, then we can take advantage of the fact that one of the symmetry planes represents this plane of isotropy, and then we can estimate all relevant Thomson-style coefficients just from this NMO ellipse, from conventional spread move out of P and S waves. So the bigger question here is, can we actually tell whether the medium is HTI or orthorhombic? And in fact, we can if we have multi-component data, because from the measurements in the isotropy plane, well, in one of the symmetry planes, we can find the ratios of the NMO velocities. And if these ratios happen to be equal to the ratios or close to the ratios of the vertical velocities, then the medium is HTI. And the ratios of the vertical velocities can be found from the vertical travel times. So if it happens in one of the symmetry planes, then the medium is close to HTI. And that's probably the most reliable indicator of HTI that we can obtain from reflection data. There is a special case, important special case that Vladimir studied in his paper with Bar Kachanov, where we have multiple vertical fracture sets in a pure isotropic background. So in this case, they show that the effective medium is close to orthorhombic, And this is described by six parameters, which are two background velocities, Vp and Vs, for P and S waves, obviously. Then, epsilon, E1 and E2 are the densities of what they call the principal fracture sets. So in reality, we might have multiple fracture sets. There's no limit on the number of these fracture sets. But the medium behaves as though an isotropy is caused by two orthogonal fracture systems. And these are their densities. And alpha 1 is the azimuth of one of these fracture sets. And zeta, I believe it's zeta, is the fluid factor. So it tells us whether the fractures are wet or dry. So this is a very special case of orthorhombic media. And if the medium happens to be HTI, this just means that one of those fracture sets has to go away. So either E1 or E2 will go to zero. So what's most important about this model is that all six coefficients can be constrained by hyperbolic move-out of PS1 in these two ways. Again, by NMO ellipses and vertical travel times. And here's an example again from Rudolphson field. And this is the work by Ivan Vasconcelos and Vladimir, where they estimated the crack densities, this principal crack densities in the reservoir. So these are interval measurements. So essentially they built an orthorhombic velocity model for the reservoir from multi-component data. So by definition, E1 corresponds to the higher crack density. If we look on the east side, on the right side of the survey, then both fracture sets are well developed, and obviously then the medium is orthorhombic. On the west side of the survey, only one of the crack densities is significant. The second fracture set basically goes away. So on the west side of the survey, the medium is close to HTI. And that would be the most appropriate way to handle this symmetry issue. We can identify HTI symmetry from the data, and then we can do a better job interpreting the results of, say, azimuthal AB1 analysis, when we know that the medium is close to HTI or orthorhombic. So let me summarize the talk, and the conclusions are obviously different from conventional spread and long spread data. By conventional spreads, we mean maximum offsets not exceeding the depth of the reflector by much, on the order of reflector depth. And then, so we talked about the NMO ellipse, AVO gradient, attenuation gradient. I haven't mentioned time migration, but for conventional spread data, the impulse response will essentially depend on the NMO ellipse. So in this case, HTI gives us the correct azimuthal function. So essentially, in each case, we have to look for a certain ellipse. In the case of NMO velocity, this result is exact. NMO velocity is always elliptical. In the case of the AVO gradient or attenuation gradient, it's an approximation. But there is no difference here between HTI and orthorhombic media. The azimuthal variation of all the signatures is close, typically is close to elliptical. So the symmetry assumption is really is not needed in processing. But it might be helpful to us in depth conversion in AVO analysis if we can tell that the medium is HTI. It really simplifies, especially the inversion of the AVO response. So can we tell HTI from orthorhombic? Well, the best way to do it is to acquire multi-component data and combine the NMO ellipses of P and S waves. With P waves, here we need some depth information. So if we have a P wave NMO ellipse, and if we know the depth or the thickness of a certain layer, then we can tell at least whether one of the delta coefficients is close to zero, which will be an indication of HTI symmetry. So for long spread data, things are very different. If we want to describe effective non-hyperbolic long spread move-out, we need to use the general orthorhombic equation, which is parameterized by C eta coefficients. So there's no way around it, even if the medium is layer cake HTI. And if we can convert effective move-out into the interval move-out, which obviously requires so minimum thickness of our target layer. Then it may help us identify HTI, because the azimuthal variation of non-hyperbolic involved is very different for HTI and for torrent media, but an important exception here is dry cracks, which do not produce any non-hyperbolic involved. For fluid-fulfilled cracks, in principle, it's possible, and we can even distinguish between single and multiple fracture sets. For the attenuation coefficient, also at large angles, the equations are different from HTI and orthorhombic media. And I haven't discussed the critical angle. It's something that we use in so-called critical angle reflectometry, but essentially the critical angle is also kind of a long offset signature. And it has a different functional form for HTI and orthorhombic media. But in both cases, it might be difficult, given the level of noise, to separate, to distinguish between the two symmetries. So here I talked about long offset reflection data, but the best calibration tool probably is long offset multi-component VSPs. Then we might be able to do inversion for the complete triclinic stiffness tensor and then figure out what the symmetry is, although it's not a trivial problem. And also it's helpful to have well logs, especially dipole sonic and FMI logs can help us image fractures. So essentially, to answer the question in the title, I would say that HTI is not completely irrelevant, but it's either dangerous or sometimes it just doesn't make sense for us to assume HTI in processing. But what it does make sense is to look for HTI in our data. And if we can establish that, say, in a certain part of our survey, the medium is HTI, that can help us in the interpretation of our data. So let me finish with acknowledgments. So I would like to acknowledge a lot of former students and colleagues whose results I used in this talk. So thank you for your attention, and I'll be happy to answer your questions. I even stayed on time.
Thank you, Nia, for wonderful, very interesting summary or review of One issue that normally, let's say, when we work with wide azimuth data with, shells or... So a very normal workflow is you go into, let's say, you assume azimuthally independent anisotropy, let's say DTI. You get the, you see that sometimes because of the shell sand, you see the effect, so you have a kind of a background DTI model. Then you run the, let's say, the migration with full azimuth information, you see the oscillations, the azimuthal independence, the periodicity, let's say, this pi over 2. So, with that regard, I mean, ultimately, I mean, what you have is only orthorhombic, right? If you wanted to assume that your, let's say, DTI layers are now, they contain also, let's say, some aligned fractures. So, in that regard, you don't have the, let's say, the freedom to go into the HTI.
And that's not what I advocate, I don't suggest using the HTI model. I think what you are talking about is equivalent to my discussion of non-hyperbolic move-out. If you look at your image gathers, it's basically the same signature. You can take away the VTI component if you want to, and then you'll be left essentially with still with the orthorhombic component. So you'll have to deal with the three ATO coefficients. And obviously it's not a good idea to say it's HTI and just set, say, one of them to zero. So it's much better to invert all three, and then it all depends on whether you can kind of reliably estimate the ATO coefficients and then tell that the medium is HTI or not. But what I also emphasized here is that if you can go to interval quantities, so in image gathers you deal with some effective parameters for each horizon. If you go to interval quantities, if you can invert for the interval move-out coefficients or somehow generate the interval image gathers, then you are in a much better position to discriminate between HTI and orthorhombic.
Yeah.
because then, yeah, you take away vertical heterogeneity, and then you can tell that the cesium-neutral variation actually fits the HTI equation, which is very simple because it depends on a single eta coefficient. But definitely, I don't advocate using the HTI equation to describe the cesium-neutral variation.
I have another question.
Yeah.
Go.
Looking at the NMO, the azimuthal NMO parameter for the force of there, so it seems to me, so it's like going to the force order, to the wide angle, you have three more parameters, right?
Yeah.
Eta 1, eta 2, eta 2. Where, as far as I know, from also from my experience, let's say with my derivations, you know, we have to, I mean, what you add for the effective parameters, if you have more than one layer, you have five parameters.
Yeah.
You have two more angles that are, because of the periodicity of the, it's not anymore the two alpha, you have four alpha, which gives you two more angles.
So these equations actually work for any orientation of the symmetry planes. You don't need anything else. So our experience just shows that you just need to account for the difference between these two angles, phi and phi 1. Even if you have a stack of, say, strongly anisotropic orthorhombic layer, this will be effective parameters. Obviously, they won't correspond to any physical azimuthal angles that will give you the orientation of the symmetry planes. But you can do a good job flattening your reflection inequality with this equation. So all these parameters are effective. And the more velocity determines the effective and the more ellipse, and the eta coefficient determine this effective non-hyperbolic move alter. These are not interval coefficients.
No, I understand. Let's discuss it after that.
Yeah, I have a question, Ilya.
Over here.
Okay.
thanks for this great overview. My question is about EMAS and the convention for computing it. For the P wave, you showed it was gamma 1 minus gamma 2, and that's proportional to crack density. But then for the HTI, you indicated that maybe it was implemented on gamma 2, which would make gamma S negative. So I'm just wondering what is the convention for computing that when maybe one of those is zero?
Well, gamma S by definition is positive. That's my long-standing argument with RCP, because I like to compute negative.
Right.
You can
have
yeah, I still
can't. So it's oriented in such a way to be with the dominant fracture set.
Yeah, basically it's the fractional difference between C4-4 and C5-5, and where you just take the absolute value. So that it's close, it's not equal to, but it's close to the fractional difference between the higher and lower S-wave velocities at vertical incidence.
Okay.
And if the medium is HTI, then it's equal to one of the gammas. And if it's orthorhombic, it's the difference between the two gammas. But the issue here is not this all simple expressions, how you interpret this coefficient. Because if you have multiple fracture sets, then gamma S will depend on the difference between the crack densities. So it won't give you the actual crack density that you are after.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, Ilya? Yeah, very interesting. Very interesting. I just want to challenge some of the conclusions a little bit.
Okay.
Or one of them. I think the model is...
Not enough haters?
No more than enough. I think the model that we probably need to use is the model that the data itself tells us is appropriate, what we could really resolve. For example, I think the HTI still has a lot of room to fill in a model where you could put an HTI in a layer. I know you. This layer might not be HTI, it might be orthorhombic, but that will be accommodated in other layers where you could have VTI as that. I know it's a more complicated as you do the layer stripping, but to be more practical, at least with this kind of a model, effectively you will end up with something very close to what you could get from your data or what fits the data. Because we are also limited, you said long spread, but it might be long spread in one direction, might not be. This is most of our acquisition long spread in the other direction, and therefore you have to somehow accommodate something in the middle.
Well, I think that you're probably thinking mostly about imaging applications where you're dealing with effective mediums. So you have a certain layer in the middle that's HDI, then you add something else, and you can kind of reproduce your...
Even mobile.
Yeah, but here I want to emphasize applications like AVO, where we actually need to know where the layer above certain reflectors, HDI or orthorhombic, above and below. So that will change our interpretation of the AVO response. I try to emphasize that for effective quantities, usually we have to go with orthorhombic equations, because we won't have a single HDI layer, even there is a certain HDI layer at depth. Right? Okay. But yeah, I agree with you. And when you can combine multiple layers and you want to reproduce your imaging operator, you can probably do it with HDI. But I don't think any of these conclusions actually are affected by this.
No, I just tried.
And again, I'm not against using HDI. Like, if subsurface with HDI would be in great shape. But the issue is not to assume HDI when we don't have enough information, because that can lead to serious errors.
I would suggest...
Wait a second.
Rick, I would suggest formulate your problem as an orthorhombic, and then make the assumptions. Let's say the special case for HDI, and then after that, see if you can get. But start with the orthorhombic representation.
Yeah.
HDI is a special case, and maybe this is only what you can get, and that's fair.
Yeah, but the degrees of freedom becomes an issue, and therefore you have to do some assumptions. And we regularize, we do different things, but sometimes you have to set a model that you could actually invert for or actually estimate the parameters for. And when you say HDI, you saw the number of ADAs really blew up in the orthorhombic, and in some consideration with certain data, maybe HDI with a mix of VTI layers in between could actually effectively give you what an orthorhombic can give at the same time with less parameters.
Okay, any other comments, Sven?
Wait a second. As I see it, this is all very interesting theory, but would it make any sense for you and your students to work on tests for somebody in industry to decide, first of all, whether a particular isotropic model is germane to a particular prospect? Because to do the processing that you describe is complicated, and there are not many people in the industry who have the knowledge to apply it meaningfully. But if you and your students could come up with some quick tests, it may be impossible, but it's worth a quest, I think, if you could find some way to tell the prospect manager that he's got an HDI problem, a VTI problem, or any kind of non-isotropic problem. I think this would be a valuable contribution.
Yes, I agree with you, but I think you may underestimate the level of processing now done in industry, because people now are doing orthorhombic imaging on many wide azimuth data sets. So Paul Fowler is here, he's been working on it for a while, Yu Zheng. So I don't think they need us to do a test of this type, because now they have a pretty good idea how to do this type of processing. I trust Paul Fowler.
Sven, just to settle your first question, all of your data is anisotropic.
Yeah, I know that, but they're different kinds. Is a quick way to determine what kind of anisotropy we're facing. We may be processing the data with the wrong models, with the incorrect anisotropic model.
Oh, I don't think there's a quick way, but I think that was most of the talk was about. I tried to point out several ways of telling what the symmetry is. It may not be quick, but that's what we have to do. So the main problem is with conventional spread data is difficult to do, which is both good and bad, because the denormalization of all the signatures is relatively simple, and we don't need a symmetry assumption. So we can do well as well. We can say it's HTI, but doesn't really matter. So what we have to use is either multi-component data or long spreads. And this is much more questionable, but that's the only kind of more or less robust way to distinguish between the symmetries. VSP is this calibration tool. It's somewhat different scale, but yes, yeah, in VSPs you can potentially you can estimate all 21 Stephen's coefficients. Actually, Leibner has done a couple of data sets. I think we probably have to stop it here and move on to Zeming. Thank you.